Good evening, friends. Welcome to one more session of the Aligarh Society of History and Archaeology and Ganga Jamuni online series of lectures and talks. It is indeed very heartening to note that our educational institutions are once again physically opening after remaining closed for almost 2 years. Some of us really missed being face to face at a breathing distance from our students, or you can say vice versa as well. An online mode of teaching can never be the same as the so-called offline mode, where during our lectures, attending or delivering, we can actually learn more. And eye-to-eye contact, as well as interactions with people of different backgrounds, is as much important as the content of the theme on which lectures are being delivered. However, the offline mode too has its own limitations. During the last 2 years, we slowly learned how to be effective online and reach audiences which we never could if confined to only offline mode. The reach of online mode is mind-boggling. We do not only connect with interested people sitting at different geographical locations simultaneously, but as these programs also remain virtually present for the time to come, many can connect and tune in even months later. But there's yet another flip side to it. And unfortunately, we witnessed that too. Anyone with the right technology could spam you with his or her half-baked ideas. We saw a mushrooming of such lectures from 2020 onwards. But then, even serious scholars and historians too gradually picked up, and their views, which had so far remained confined to highbrow circles, slowly gained traction amongst the masses. We at Asha and Ganga Jamuni also experimented and strove to bring knowledge outside our classrooms. Scholars from various parts of the world and country were requested to deliver talks or introduce their works to the people who chose to tune in. We tried to bring before you only those views which are backed by primary sources. We tried to sift the truth from a stack of unreliable myths. We discussed sources. We discussed important themes. We discussed books. We even discussed movies and even paintings. Today is Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj Jayanti, a festival and public holiday as far as Maharashtra is concerned. This festival is celebrated on every 19th of February. And this day is supposed to be the birth anniversary of Shivaji Maharaj, the founder of the Maratha Empire. On this occasion, we have Professor Shraddha Kumbhojkar, who will talk to us about depiction of Marathas in Mumbai films with reference to the movie Bajirao Mastani, which was produced in 2015. It was a film which tries to depict the star-crossed relationship between the protagonists on the backdrop of the expansion of the Peshwa dominance beyond Deccan. Dr. Kumbhojkar is a historian of Western India and a die-hard fan of Priyanka, Ranveer Singh and Deepika. She will talk about the authenticity of the depiction of the Peshwa household and about the credibility of the tangible and non-tangible sources used in the movie. She will discuss where the film pinpoints the raw nerves of the state in 18th century. She will also try to engage with the larger politics of making a film to entrench a certain religious and caste identification of a regime, which is essential to the present day political agendas. Presently, Dr. Kumbhojkar is not only a professor of history, but also heads the Department of History at Savitribai Phule, Pune University. She did her master's first in history and then in Sanskrit. Her doctoral thesis, entitled Nationalistic Interpretations of Ancient Indian Texts, Maharashtra during 1885-1929, is something which, in fact, places her into the domain of ancient Indian history. In her career as a university teacher spanning more than 25 years, she has developed a research interest not only in ancient India, in which she has done her research, but also modern Indian history, European intellectual history, historiography, memory studies, and Dalit studies. She has contributed a large number of research papers as well as articles. Her articles have been published in journals like EPW, Samaj Prabodhan Patrika, and Lok Satta. Whereas her research has been acknowledged and presented in international conferences held over Europe and Australia, also Far East, and also conferences held in United States of America. She has delivered lectures in a large number of universities, both international as well as local. I welcome Professor Shraddha Kumbhojkar, who very kindly agreed to be with us today. Over to you, Shraddha. Please do tell us something about this particular movie, and through that movie also inform how the Marathas are being perceived now, and what was the actual truth behind that. Over to you.
Thank you ever so much, Professor Rezavi, who's a dear friend and, of course, a senior and respected colleague. It is indeed an honor, sir, to be a part of this initiative wherein, as you very rightly pointed out, the space which was claimed by non-specialists is slowly being reclaimed by the people who have been trained in history, who have worked hard to attain certain skills as far as the historical sciences are concerned. So this technology, the field of online studies, it is indeed a novel thing for us. It's not something that we are all familiar with. But as Professor Rezavi pointed out, we are definitely learning how to use technology in order to reach out to the masses, to reach out to the people who are interested in history, which is our core subject. History, of course, is not something which is a boring subject or anything, because in textbooks, it can be a boring subject, but when it comes to our real lives, when it comes to its depiction in films, in literature, in different kinds of media, even in games, video games, online video games, it becomes an extremely interesting subject, and people are really, really curious to know more, to explore more as far as our own past is concerned. I thought that taking the example of a film, which is fairly recent as far as our public memory is concerned, one could perhaps try and see how our own past is presented and represented, how it is constructed anew for the masses who are eager to try and understand our own story of the past. Hence, I thought that I'll discuss with the example of this, call it a case study, if you like, of a movie called as Bajirao Mastani, which was created and it opened to huge full house audiences back in 2015. Also, as Professor Rezavi rightly pointed out, I'm a big fan of course, Priyanka Chopra, Deepika Padukone, and Ranveer, also of the Mumbai film industry, because it has its own strengths, which is to unify this huge subcontinent of South Asia, and also it creates a lot of soft power as far as the Indian way of living is concerned all over the world. So you go to Moscow, you go to whichever place, you will find people whistling to the songs of Mumbai film industry. So it's always a great factor which brings us, which connects us to the world outside. Also because the film industry, the kind of films that are made in the Mumbai film industry, they act as if they are, you know, cultural ambassadors of our culture for the world, for the people abroad. So people do have their impressions about India, which are largely influenced by the Mumbai films, is what I have experienced when I've interacted with people. One knows, of course, that that's not a completely 100% correct depiction, but people do think along those lines when they try to gauge what to expect when comes across somebody belonging to the Indian culture, the South Asian culture broadly, not just the Indian culture. And hence, I thought that this might be a useful way of trying to see how history is represented and how it is presented before the audiences. Since this is going to be an interaction about a movie and it's how do we make sense of it, I think it will be interesting if I just start with sharing a small scene from the movie. It might get interesting as compared to just me speaking with the people here. So let me try and share a small scene from the movie. I hope that I can share the screen. Shagupta,
please show the screen. Shagupta, show the screen. Show the screen, please. Shagupta, the video.
Yeah.
Surya kirno ke bina, khushbu hawa ke bina, aur raja pradhan ke bina adhura hai. Maratha samrajya ke mukhya pradhan Peshwa Balaji Vishwanath ke nidhan se hamare samne ek bahut bada prashn hai. Naye Peshwa ka chunav koi?
Yes, So the movie opens. I hope the movie thing has stopped, and I hope I am audible here. So the movie opens up. Thank you, sir.
Yes, you are audible.
So the movie opens up with this crisis, as it were, as far as the Maratha state of early 18th century is concerned, wherein the first Peshwa, I'll come back to what is a Peshwa, wherein the first Peshwa has just passed away, and the emperor is trying to find out if which person should be the next Peshwa. As far as the Maharashtrian empire of Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, whose birth anniversary we are celebrating today, as far as Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj's empire is concerned, we all know that he was coronated in 1674, and after a few years of his regime, he passed away, and then his sons were ruling and trying to expand the empire. The point here is that this is not about the succession of the Chhatrapati, that is the king, but this is about the succession of a Peshwa, who was for all practical purposes the prime minister. And for some of us who are familiar with the Japanese history, the relationship is somewhat like the emperor and the shogun. So Mikado and shogun. So it is the emperor who is the de jure, the legal head of the empire, but de facto the real power has kind of shifted into the hands of the Peshwa, starting with the first Peshwa, Balaji Vishwanath, and after his demise, now one can see in the movie that these people are, we have the Chhatrapati, who's a descendant of Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, and he's saying that we want to find out who's going to be the next Peshwa, who will be ably handling the affairs of the kingdom, so to speak. As far as the movie goes, what I'll do is I'll start with certain details which speak of anomalies as far as the real Maratha life is concerned and the depiction in the movie. And eventually, I will also go towards the meta-narrative as to what the film is trying to show us, what is it, what kind of a narrative they are trying to build for us. So here one can see certain things which really do not fit in with the picture of Maratha empire of these times. First and foremost, of course, the Chhatrapati that they have shown, Chhatrapati, the king, the king of the Maratha empire, his age when Peshwa Balaji Vishwanath passed away was just 38 years. And the person that is shown here in the movie is definitely a lot older. So the age does not match, one. Secondly, the kind of depiction that is made of the darbar, of the royal court of the Chhatrapati, is also a bit too grand. Such chandeliers and, you know, waterways within the building, all these pompous and very, very rich and long-lasting kind of architectural features and things in the palace, these were not really a part of the ambience, the cultural ambience, as far as the time period that the movie is dealing with. This was not how the Chhatrapati operated in his mahal, which was at Satara, in his palace, which was at Satara. Third very important thing that I thought I'll highlight here is that the depiction of the people, the courtiers here, is quite filmy and flimsy. Reason being that all of these people are wearing a similar kind of a dress, similar kind of a headgear, and they're sitting in a very similar kind of a position, which is not how things operated as far as Chhatrapati Shahu Maharaj's court was concerned. Being an emperor, though of obviously not a grand scale, but of a major, major regional power, definitely, Chhatrapati Shahu Maharaj's court did consist of a number of people from different castes, different backgrounds as far as religions were concerned, different regions, Maharashtra being, you know, at the mid area of the Indian subcontinent. So this is Deccan. This is where people come from all sorts of places. If we are reminded of Malik Ambar, who came all the way from Abyssinia, from Ethiopia, and ruled in the Bahmani times. So this is a place which is at crossroads, and this is definitely a place of cultural confluences, and not a place wherein you can see such monotony as far as the courtiers are concerned. So this depiction is a bit too posh to be true. That's what I wanted to highlight. Then maybe we can go to the next clip and talk about something different.
है जो स्वयं इस जिम्मेदारी को स्वीकार करे, बल्कि तीर से दो हिस्सों में तोड़ना होगा बाजीराव. शास्त्र चलाकर तुम्हें शास्त्र की समझ भी देनी होगी.
अब देखते हैं चीते की चाल और बाज की नजर.
Yeah, this is where they've shown that the Peshwa has to kind of prove himself in order to be selected for the position of Peshwa. That is, this person, Bajirao, has to prove himself. Now, we do not have any historical evidence of any such tests being designed or offered to the incumbent Peshwa. We simply do not have any evidence of such process of selection of the Peshwa. So this is a completely fictionalized and improbable account. Though the position of the Peshwa became hereditary in legal terms, that is, it was written down that this will be a hereditary position. Slightly later, when the Chhatrapati was about to pass away without an heir, that is the time when he wrote down saying that, requesting the Peshwas to kind of carry on the mantle. But even during the times of the Bajirao, the first Bajirao, there is no evidence of such selection process having taken place. So that is also another quite anomalous kind of depiction as far as the film is concerned. Then is where I want to reach. Yeah.
ऐसा चाहते हैं.
तुको जी, हम अपनी लड़ाई लड़े या उनकी मदद करें, हमें सिरोंजा पहुंचना है. उन्हें वापस भेज दो.
पर वो सैनिक श्रीमंत से मिलने की जीत कर रहा है.
तुको जी, निगाह.
जी.
This is the scene where Peshwa Bajirao is on the move. He has become the Peshwa and he's trying to, you know, expand his influence in the north, that is north of Deccan. And this is when in the next scene, we'll be seeing the beautiful Deepika entering the movie. Her entry is there. But before that, this scene is trying to depict the Peshwa on the move, and he's supposed to be in a tent and he's supposed to be moving around. Am I audible?
We had lost you for some time. Now you are audible.
Now I am audible. Yeah, because I could see the buffering thing. So this is a scene where they are on the move, and moving, of course, in camps and moving from one place to another. The thing that I find hilarious here is these two statues, which you can see between the Peshwa, who's sitting and trying to pinpoint locations, how they are going to plan their journey, and the messenger. The messenger, of course, is wearing the, the whole, what is the word for that? The jacket thing, the armor, yeah. The armor, which is obviously not something that is worn unless you are going to fight, because armors tend to be very heavy, and this is just a messenger, so there's no reason why he should be wearing that armor and the whole thing. But anyway, the most hilarious thing that I find here are the two statues, and these are simply anachronous and out of place here. These are the statues which are obviously showpieces which we use these days of Prussian soldiers, Roman soldiers, that stuff. Why would somebody who's moving from one place to another, they are trying to go on battlefield, why would they have showpieces in their tents which are on the move? There's simply no reason why those things should be there. Also, the kind of tent that they have shown is not definitely something which was in vogue as far as the Maratha camps were concerned. So this is something that I find quite out of place. The most hilarious thing is the thing on the right side. Yeah, the coat of arms at the back. On the background, this is a very, very, very serious, out of place thing, anomaly thing which should not be here. This is something to do with the British people and their coat of arms, and you have universities such as Oxford and Cambridge, and you have various houses of lords where they have their family coat of arms, and these are basically insignia to show that something belongs to a particular family or a particular institution. This is not something that was in vogue, that was in practice as far as the Peshwas were concerned. So in the next scene, when we'll see the Nizam, we can see his insignia in the tent, which is perfectly fine because the Nizam did have that kind of an insignia. But here in the Peshwa tent, what this coat of arms is doing is anybody's guess. It's just shoddy work on the part of the person who was looking after the property or art direction. Let's just move on to the next scene, which...
आगे कभी नहीं हो सकती। राम जी के हम कोई राजा नहीं है, केवल छत्रपति शाहू के सेवक हैं।
पर लोग तो यही कहते हैं कि बालक छत्रपति है, पर चालक तो उनके पेशवाई हैं।
Yes, this is again a scene which is supposed to be a meeting between the Peshwa and the Nizam. Again, why so many showpieces are around when people are supposed to be on the move? They're leaving the place within 8 days, 10 days. Why would they have such huge showpieces? Is simply something that beats me. It's just not, it should not be there. But the dialogues here between the Nizam and the Peshwa, they are quite pertinent, and I think that they make a lot of sense. Because the Nizam says that for all practical purposes, it is you who's considered as the ruler, and Peshwa Bajirao says that no, that is not the case. It is the Chhatrapati who is the real ruler, and I am only his servant. So this awareness of the authority that stems from the the fountainhead of the authority being the Chhatrapati, this awareness was definitely there as far as Bajirao first, the Peshwa, was concerned. But eventually, as the generations passed, what happened was the Peshwas seem to have forgotten this link with the Chhatrapatis. They seem to have begun to enjoy their power and take their decisions on their own. But the dialogue that just went by between the Nizam and Bajirao is quite praiseworthy from my point of view, that the awareness of the Peshwas being the prime ministers of the Chhatrapati is very much there in the mind of Bajirao. So kudos to the director for this one, definitely. And then I'll try and share a different scene, and hopefully Shagufta, can you share the other video?
शगुफ्ता is this the one?
No, this is a PPT. Shagufta, the video. Okay, while she tries to connect that other video, let me just try and switch to the meta narrative of it, going from the small little pieces of evidence that we were discussing just now. I think that the movie is an attempt to try and show the love story between Bajirao, who's definitely somebody who is a high caste born person ruling. Eventually, his empire expands to large territory in North India, north of the Narmada. And the love story is between this person who's very, very powerful, Bajirao, and his lover, who's Mastani. She happens to be a daughter of one of the rulers in Bundelkhand. So this is an inter-regional, inter-caste, inter-class, inter-linguistic kind of a love story. And I think it's a really, really praiseworthy thing for the director to have chosen such a subject back in 2013 or 14, when he must have started with the entire project of making the film. Inter-religious, inter-caste, that is basically trying to transgress the boundaries of what love should and should not be like, as given by the society, as prescribed by the society around us. That is something. Thank you, Shabu.
मधुंदरों को संदेशा भेज दिया. अरे मिठाई किस खुशी में बांटी जा रही है आज? कोई त्योहार, पूजा पाठ, आया क्या?
अरे लाया कौन?
हम लेकर आए हैं. लीजिए लीजिए, सबको दीजिए. ए चिमा जी, खा, मुझे पसंद ही जाए. भरपूर खा.
आज अचानक मिठाई की बजाय श्रीमान,
हमारे बेटे का नामकरण हुआ है. हमने कृष्णा का नाम बदल दिया.
और क्या रखा उसका नाम? पेशवा.
एंड इफ यू कुड गो अ लिटिल बिट एट द बैक व्हेन ही इज सिटिंग.
की बजाय श्रीमान,
सबको दीजिए. ए चिमा जी, खा, मुझे पसंद ही जाए.
Thank you so much. Yeah, so this is a scene where Bajirao Peshwa is, and earlier I was speaking about the meta narrative and of a story between star-crossed lovers. This is where Bajirao has to take a painful decision, that is, he has to ascribe a religion to his child, the son that is born from the marriage with Mastani. The Brahmin stronghold of the priesthood and the ruling, the relatives who are obviously of high caste and belonging to Bajirao's family, they offer a stern resistance to the idea of Bajirao being married to somebody who does not belong to the prescribed boundaries of what can be acceptable love. And hence, there is a lot of opposition to his love to Mastani. And I think it's a very, very admirable effort on the part of the director to have shown the tensions, to have shown the kind of quarrels that go on within the family when Bajirao, tries to gain acceptance from the family for this relationship with Mastani. Here, what is important in this specific scene is that relatives, his own cousins, his own brothers, his own servants also, his own trusted confidants, colleagues, all of them show a great amount of resistance to Bajirao naming his son in the Hindu fashion. So they say that this is not something which is acceptable according to the Hindu traditions, which are of course, as we all know, defined and redefined as per the convenience of the powers that be. But here it is strange that Bajirao is practically ruling a large chunk of what is today's India, and still he has to face a stiff resistance from the Brahmanical patriarchy, if we like, from his home front. One can understand, of course, the women of the house hating Mastani, who's a co-wife or another wife. That is perfectly understandable. But why the colleagues, why the male people, members of the household of the Peshwa, why do they hate Mastani so much, and why do they offer such stern resistance to Bajirao? That is something that has to be given a great deal of thought, in my opinion. Here in this specific picture, the director has definitely tried to touch on the, as I said, the raw nerve of this love between people who, quote unquote, should not be loving each other, because it benefits people when two people from different backgrounds hate each other. It is just beneficial for some people. Here, these two people are beating the expectations, and instead of hating each other, they are loving each other and trying to gain acceptance from the society. So that much part on the part of the director, perfectly fine, acceptable. But here what he's tried to show, at the back of Bajirao, is something that is completely, completely, again, historically untrue. It is just not right. The map of India, which is shown on the back side of Bajirao here, we know, and we have specimens of maps which were created by the Peshwas. And we know that this kind of a map of the Indian peninsula with latitudes and longitudes and all those things, which are perfectly drawn here at the back of Bajirao. This kind of technology, this kind of perspective, this kind of understanding of latitudes, longitudes, and the whole science of cartography was simply not practiced by the Peshwas. Here, of course, one can argue that he might have borrowed it, he might have got it as a gift from the East India Company people or some, whoever else, other rulers. But the hilarious part of it is that on the left shoulder of Bajirao, if you look slightly above, you can see the words Akhand Bharat written over there. And also that hilarious logo or insignia of some kind of a British firm or family, which is completely out of place. The British insignia should not be there, one. Secondly, the words Akhand Bharat, what are they doing here? So if it is a map that Bajirao has got as a gift from some kind of a foreign power, maybe the Portuguese or the English or the Dutch, whatever, why would they write it as Akhand Bharat on the map? Akhand Bharat is a concept that has come into being only after India was partitioned, or at least ideologically it was partitioned. So this is a big, big anomaly and big blooper as far as the movie is concerned. It should not be there. This concept obviously was just not there when Bajirao was ruling. But having said that, I think it is very, very important for us to remember that Bajirao faced stiff resistance from his family, from the male members of his family, as well as the female members, for the love that he tried to nurture as far as his relationship with Mastani was concerned. So this hate-mongering, this opposition to love, between people of different backgrounds is something that is very real, and I think it is very, very appreciable on the part of the filmmakers to have shown that. So much about the different scenes from the movie. As far as the architecture goes, and here I have not been able to show you the scenes, you know, download the scenes and show them here. But the arches that are shown in some of the songs, which are really, really famous, you know, the Mastani song and everything. The arches are Gothic kind of, Indo-Gothic at best kind of arches, which were just not available, and they were not in vogue as far as the Peshwa household is concerned. So architecturally also, they have been a bit careless, the filmmakers. Another thing that one can think of is the kind of relationship between the women in the film, that is the dance that they have shown, the Pinga song. They look like $1 million, both of them, Priyanka as well as Deepika. Priyanka's, you know, her emoting the tussle between her emotions, that is fantastic. But it is historically, I mean, one can find source materials which say that Kashibai had some kind of a problem, some kind of a deformity, or the word that is used is vyatha, pain. So she had some kind of a problem in her leg, and obviously it is not possible for this lady of the house to have performed such a beautiful dance as far as Pinga, the song is concerned. Secondly, the kind of dance steps, that is, the choreographers also have to be historically conscious. The kind of dance steps that they have shown are not really the kind of dances that are performed in a high caste Hindu household of the 18th century. These dance steps come from the what is popularly shown as Launi dance, the theatrical performance, which is supposed to be kind of attractive and, you know, trying to win over the hearts of the audiences in a more open kind of way. But the women of the house in a Brahmin household would never dance in such a fashion. So that choreography is also it is flawed in my opinion. Also something that I wanted to highlight was the headgear. The heads used to be covered by and large as far as the official settings are concerned. And here in the first scene, when Bajirao is shown without mustache and without, you know, his head is completely tonsured, clean-shaven head, it is perfectly understandable because his father has recently passed away. And it is a custom that when your one of the parents passes away, then the eldest son at least tonsures his hair. So that is perfectly understandable in the first scene. But later on, why Bajirao has to move around with uncovered head is something that is completely out of place here. Because there is a specific word for having the head uncovered. And up until the 19th century, even in the early 20th century, moving around with bodka, doka, that is, if your head is uncovered, it was considered as a very, very rude kind of a demeanor. So in a formal setting, moving around with no headgear is something that is not acceptable and not historically authentic. All these details might seem like hair splitting or, you know, baal ki khal nikalna, but what I'm trying to drive at is the larger part of the argument, which is about how does one make sense of having such a movie made in the year 2015 and the movie trying to claim historical authenticity, credibility, and wielding such power over the historical understanding of the masses. This brings me to the concluding part of the interaction. I think that the movie has a dual kind of a takeaway for me. The positive side is that they dared to show the tussle as far as the family relations between the Peshwa, within the Peshwa family and the Brahmanical priesthood, as far as those relations are concerned, they were really, really brave in showing those kinds of tensions within the Peshwa household. The flip side is that they could have been more careful as far as the property is concerned, as far as the ambience that they have tried to show is concerned. As far as the dress, the language, the dances are concerned, they should have been more careful. Just another example that comes to my mind is that in the first scene, when we were seeing the Peshwa trying to make a choice of the new, the Chhatrapati trying to make the choice of a new Peshwa, one can see so many little lamps that were lit inside the Darbar. And this is completely, completely unacceptable and not authentic at all. Primarily because the houses used to have a lot of wood as far as the 18th and the 19th century houses were concerned in the Deccan region. So may it be in Satara, may it be in Pune, why would somebody light so many lamps which do not substantially even add to the existing amount of lighting? Secondly, the Darbar proceedings used to take place mostly during the daytime. So no point in having the lights, you know, lit up by so many. It consumes a lot of labor also. Thirdly, with so much of wood being used in the architecture, why would somebody light oil lamps inside the wooden pillars, which is nothing less than an invitation to a big fire disaster? So it is completely anachronistic, it is completely anomalous, it is just not credible to have so many lights all over. They look beautiful, definitely, they add a lot of visual value, but they give you a touch of not being authentic, not being credible. Talking of the last concluding part of this interaction, which is about why such a movie is made, why such a depiction is made. The flip side, as far as I'm concerned, is that I think that the film industry, when they try to approach a historical subject, what they are looking out for, just like the common masses, is something which is on a grand, grand scale, something that is visually pleasing, something that might be be appreciated for its sheer beauty. But in the bargain, somewhere the authenticity, the credibility is lost. And we all know that the films that we enjoy are the films where we have willing suspension of belief. So we know that there is going to be a element of untruth. But when films make a claim to authenticity, when films try to show something at such a large scale, I don't see any benefit that these filmmakers get out of showing such anomalous, such untrue things. There's no benefit by showing all these lamps. You know, they could have simply shown a daytime darbar, or they simply could have shown a different kind of interaction between Kashibai and Mastani. They could have shown a different kind of a tent as far as the other earlier scene on the move for the Peshwas is concerned. Then the question comes, why is it that they resort to these grand things? One, definitely to win over the masses and to make it all very visually pleasing. But at places such as this Akhand Bharat picture or another thing where they showed the Chhatrapati trying to select the Peshwa through a meritorious kind of a selection process, one suspects that there are reasons other than just visual pleasantness when they are trying to depict these things. What could those reasons be? It depends, of course, on the filmmakers and the times and all those things. But here in this case, I think the historian looks at history through a much more textured kind of a fashion. We try to differentiate between, let's say, early 19th century and late 18th century and what blah, blah, so on and so. Even with decades, we are very careful which decade we are speaking of. But for the filmmakers and perhaps for the film goers, everything that has happened has kind of gone beyond a particular veil of time. And perhaps they think that 18th century, 19th century, 12th century, it's all the same. And one can take liberty and show anything and everything that they feel like showing. That carelessness, not having enough enthusiasm to go into the details is something that worries me. Another possible reason could be what has been proven time and again, and that is the present day agendas are imposed on the past by all of us at all times. I'm not saying that it is only the filmmakers who do it, it is only the historians who do it. Everybody tries to, you know, portray what they want to see in their present imposing or superimposing the past events with your present day dreams and utopias. Here in this case, the Akhand Bharat and the coat of arms, these two things are really, really upsetting in the sense that they could have done without them. They could have made it into a nice movie wherein there is a lot of family interaction and tensions and, tussles between members of a family, as I said, star-crossed lovers, that kind of a thing. But why this Akhand Bharat? Why this trying to show the Peshwas as if, you know, they knew all these fancy things? In those days, of course, even the northward pointing maps, that is not something that was used by the Peshwas definitely in the 18th century. So why show these modern things in a period which is definitely pre-modern? And there one suspects that there may be this eagerness to show that we also had something, we are not less than anything, any other competitors, so on and so forth. But there's no reason for a filmmaker to do that. We all know that films can have their own entertainment value and they can show things in a beautiful fashion. And just the way the Mumbai film industry has been doing, they can act as a great tool of soft power. I think there's no need for the filmmakers to, cross that, not cross really. I think there's no need for the filmmakers to be historically untrue in order to wield that kind of a soft power. They are doing beautifully. Please do continue doing great films. They keep making beautiful, beautiful films year and year, over and over again. Please do continue making such films, but not at the cost of historical truth and authenticity. That would be my historian's take as far as the movie Baji. Thank you for being patient with my interaction. Thanks.
Thank you. I think Shraddha, that was a beautiful, description of the movie. You raised a few questions, but within us, I think, after hearing what you had to say, a number of questions did arise in our minds. In fact, I mean, those questions arose even at the time when, for the first time, I went to see this movie. I mean, there are very few movies which I have seen, but fortunately or unfortunately, this was one of those which I had seen, and later on, I actually repented having gone to see such a movie. There are a number of very good directors of Bollywood. Sanjay Leela Bhansali is one of them. Ashutosh Govarikar is the other. You know, I will start this by pointing out something which happened during the course of a seminar in Bombay. At a time when Ashutosh Govarikar was making his Jodha Akbar. There was a seminar in which Professor Shirin Musfi, myself from AMU, and Sunisa Zaidi and Inayat Zaidi from Jamia, they were invited. I mean, if you remember that there was much hangama regarding this movie, its historical content. So a lot of historians were invited to a conference, to a seminar, in which a special panel was put up for this. I'm forgetting the name of that director. He is supposed to be very famous. Bombaiya film ka, a very senior one, of Bengali origin. I am forgetting his name. He was there along with Ashutosh and others. Shiri Musfi presented a paper on Akbar, the controversy of Jodha. I pointed out to the architectural points, elements which were there, in which period, what. And both of us, in fact, all of us, tried to be very critical about the way that Ashutosh was going ahead making this movie. So this particular director, he stood up and in fact, he brushed all of us aside, you historians. And he said that aap history bechte hain, hum movie bechte hain. Aapki dry baatein kaun dekhega, kaun sunega? Hame to usko bechna hai. All of us were a little shocked by his response. But actually, if you come to think of it, there was a truth behind it. After all, they have to sell. It's a commercial enterprise. Right, I understand that, the commercial point of view, agar aap gala sets nahi dikhaoge, you said that the queen had some limp or some problem with her leg. She couldn't dance, but agar movie mein, agar Sanjay Leela Bhansali unka dance nahi dikhayenge, to rikshe wale kahan se dekhne aayenge. So, they have a problem, and there are certain things which can be explained. Mughal-e-Azam is one of the greatest movies, historical movies made. The only historical thing in that movie is that Akbar was really the emperor of Hindustan. And yes, he also used to live in Agra. And that his son's name was Salim. Even in his family matters, poor guy had no wife known as Jodha. Lekin movie banni thi to banai gayi. Unfortunately, the sets, they were all palaces of the Shahjahani period. So those cusp arches, those palaces, big large halls which possibly Akbar would have never seen. They were all there. And the movie sold, and till date it is one of the most popular movies. Ashutosh Govarikar made Jodha Akbar, a retake on the same on the same lines as Mughal-e-Azam, the grandeur of the Mughal Empire. Again, but I would say that as compared to what K. Asif had done, There were certain historical elements which were shown by Ashutosh, after all, because the type of interactions he had with historians were much, much more than what K. Asif might have had, although K. Asif took many, many years to make his movie. Lekin inse Ashutosh ke saath hum logon pe Irfan Habib se leke, Satish Chandra se leke, I mean, you name a top historian, he was on his head. And all of them together held. Hum jaise chote log bhi beech beech pe kuch bolne ke liye maujood rehte the. So, I mean, the end result was that in Jodha Akbar, except for the fact that Nahargarh mein shooting ho rahi thi, to again Shahjahani cusps and arches. But one of the first revolts under Akbar was faithfully depicted. His policy of Sulekul was faithfully depicted. His attraction towards the Rajputs, his going into the market without his army, all those things were shown by Ashutosh. The only thing is ke jaise unhone kaha tha ke bhai baaz dafa humko bechne ke liye kuch karna padta hai, to all those ideas of Sulekul were shown to be derived from Jodha. Akbar ki den nahi thi, wo to Rajputon ka tha jisse unhone derive kar liya tha. So, but that is understandable, right? So what I am trying to say is ke aap liberties lete hain film mein, bagair liberty liye I agree ke nahi ban sakti, lekin kuch liberties aisi hoti hain jo senior serious historians understand kar lenge. But there are certain things which show your wrong intent. Now, for example, the movie which you were talking about. Now, here, as you showed on the map, a slogan which appeared for the first time after independence, but gained popularity only and only at the time when the movie was being made. Right. And it was a slogan which supported a political dispensation and wanted to project one community versus the other. So, I would, Sanjay Leela Bhansali is a very great director and a very great cinematographer, but I would doubt his very intentions while making such a movie, because it is not the only thing which is there. There are a number of other things. Now, for example, agar, as a whole, if you look at this movie, जो मेरा परसेप्शन था, आई मीन यू आर एन एक्सपर्ट ऑन दैट, आई एम नॉट अ मूवी बफ, मैंने जिंदगी में इतनी मूवी देखी होंगी कि इन हाथों पे काउंट की जा सकती है, सो आई एम नो जज ऑफ दैट, बट यू नो द एंटायर इंटेंशन ऑफ दिस मूवी, देयर आर टू पॉसिबली टू इंटेंशंस, वन समहाउ टू शो टू द मॉडर्न पब्लिक of India, which is getting belligerent on the basis of religion, that Marathas were no less than the Mughals. I mean, it appears that entire sets from Mughal-e-Azam, for example, that scene, I mean, I wish you could have shown that scene where the dance takes place in a hall of mirrors. ये डांस कर रही हैं, ऊपर से देख रहे हैं, एंड हर इमेजेस, आई मीन शी सराउंडेड बाय हर ओन इमेजेस, एंड विद द यू नो बाजीराव सिटिंग ऑन द थ्रोन. किसी को भी मुगले आजम का वो गाना याद आ जाएगा. ऑल ऑफ अस नो दैट सच decorations were not within the courts, they were reserved for hammams. For example, in Delhi fort or in Agra fort, irrespective of that, ye chahe wo court ke andar hota ho ya hammam ke andar hota ho, let's not pick things up so minutely, but such type of grand halls with mirror decorations started only during the period of Shah Jahan. Right. Now suddenly Sanjay Leela Bhansali, picks up the set from Mughal-e-Azam. Agar Mughal aise, kyunki dekhiye problem kya hai ki Mughal-e-Azam mein jitni bhi kharabiyan ho, jitna bhi ahistorical ho, lekin Mughal term ko usne awam mein establish kar diya. Europeans started calling their tycoons or anyone who was massively rich as the Mughal. Wahi kaam jo yahan ke English officers ne apne London ja ke kiya tha ya France ja ke kiya tha, wahi kaam ke Asif ne Mughal-e-Azam bana ke Akbar-e-Azam ko ek tarike se present kar diya tha. Sanjay Leela Bhansali ka jo mujhe intention samajh mein aata hai is movie ko banane mein, ke jaise Mughals aur Akbar ko Mughal-e-Azam ne establish kiya tha, usi level pe laake Marathon ko khada kiya jaye. Unfortunately, since a number of years, I'm sorry I'm taking much of your time, a number of years, there is one thing which is circulating. Half truths, Shraddha, are more dangerous than entire lies.
Completely.
Now there is a term, Handava Dharmudharak. The protector of Hindu faith. Na mera translation galat hai, na ye fact galat hai ki Shivaji ne ye title liya tha. The only problem is that one has to see in what context this was taken up. Unfortunately, in the last few decades, it's Mughals versus Shivaji or Mughals versus Marathas. And such movies, in fact, go a long way to project those things. You point out that in the tent, when they are on the move, there are certain things which should not have been depicted. I mean, I'm really surprised at Sanjay Leela Bhansali, ke agar unko kuch dikhana hi tha, to zara Jodhpur se le jaate. In Jodhpur Palace Museum, Fort Museum, you have those Shah Jahani tents which are now with the Rajputs. Jo public wahan aati, ko, I have been there. Uspe baqaida likha hua hai ki ye Mughal tent hai, possibly used by Shah Jahan, which was taken up by one of the rulers, Jaswant Singh. At the time, just before the Rathore rebellion, it was taken by him, and then it came in the possession of the Rajputs. Lekin jo public wahan line laga ke dekhne aati hai, wo usko aise dekhti hai ki dekhiye Rajputon ka ye tha, hai na? To wahi utha ke usko dikha dete. Why depict things which actually belong to permanent palaces? Now, talking about that map which they hung behind it, kya Sanjay Leela Bhansali ye dikhana chah rahe the ke these Marathas were marauders, looters? It's a typical European map, as you rightly said. Wo jo usme ship bani hui hai, that's a typical depiction jo European companies apne uspe dikhati thi. As you rightly pointed out, that the cartography under the Mughals, or not under the Mughals, during 17th century or till 18th century, was of a different kind. Given the fact that Marathas had much more naval power than the Mughals, given the fact that agar inke kahin upar agar ship ka depiction aata hai to believable hoga, lekin kam se kam ek usko wo jo Indian ship hoti thi usko hi dikha dete, hai na. The entire attempt is to prove the grandeur of the people. Jo coat of arms hai, that again is an attempt to show. You pointed out that the Nizam did have a coat of arms, but Marathas, naturally, I mean, na unka wo status tha, na wo unke paas paraphernalia tha. As you point out, ke coat bhi unka aisa nahi hota, kuch bhi nahi hota tha. So, lekin unko sabko us setting ko provide karne ke liye, that was all, I mean, which was tried to be shown. So, jo aapne last pe jo passage tha aapka presentation ka, why it was done. So it is very, very clear why, because throughout the movie, there is much compromise which has been made with historical truth and with facts. And the end result is that those who go to see the movie, they will start having a mental setup jahan pe wo pukarenge ke haan Maratha power thi, aur Rushbrook Williams ki jo theory thi jo angrezon ne colonial period mein di thi ke agar ye kambakhte mughal na aa gaye hote to jo Hindu Raj tha, so called Hindu Raj. They also forget that Hindu term itself is very problematic for that period of time. But you also point out about the dance which has been shown. Oh, theek hai, I'm not going into that aspect ke wo dance kar sakti thi ke nahi kar sakti thi. As I said, ke unko dikhana tha, to dikha diya. Lekin, for example, during our programs, you see, Asha Ganga Jamni ki series mein, we had a lecture by Catherine Schofield, and she pointed out in one of her lectures that in fact the music which has been, and the musical instruments and music which has been shown there, has no concern with that period of time, neither the Marathas nor the Indians. It was typically European instruments in the way they were being made. Bilkul aaj kal ka jo rap wo jo hota hai, वो उस अंदाज पे उसको दिखाया गया था. Obviously, as you also point out that the choreography is also majorly flawed. So, in fact, nothing in this movie. Grandeur है, there is no doubt. मतलब देख के जो जिसको history के बारे में ना मालूम करना हो, या भूल जाइए कि आप history देख रहे हैं. अगर सिर्फ आपको 3 घंटा रिलैक्स करना हो, और जो आजकल का 2014 से जो फलसफा बढ़ाया जा रहा है उसको समझना हो और मानना हो, तो संजय लीला भंसाली की ये मूवी, जैसा कि एक आशुतोष गोवारिकर की मोहनजोदड़ो थी, है ना, बिल्कुल उसी अंदाज की. लेट्स हैव अ डिस्कशन ऑन मोहनजोदड़ो एट सम अदर पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम, how they have actually, Ashutosh Govarikar has massacred the entire history of the country by making that movie Mohenjo-daro. But this is it. I'm really thankful to you for making people understand kya ho raha hai, and let us have some of the questions which have been put up for you. I wish कि जो आपका जो स्लाइड्स बनी थी वो भी थोड़ा सा और चल जाता, टाइम था, लेकिन कोई बात नहीं. चलिए, मिर्जा हसनैन हैज आस्क्ड, व्हाट आर द हिस्टोरिकल सोर्सेस टू नो अबाउट हिस्ट्री ऑफ मस्तानी, एंड व्हेन द लव स्टोरी ऑफ बाजीराव मस्तानी स्टार्टेड अपीयरिंग इन लिटरेचर एंड आर्ट्स फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम. Mirza asked, and before you know, Shraddha takes up that question, मैं एक छोटा सा एक वो बता दूं. जब श्रद्धा और इनके कलीग्स के इनविटेशन पे व्हेन आई वेंट टू पुणे फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम, तो थोड़ा सा पुणे भी देखने गया था. एंड सडनली आई डिस्कवर्ड कि मस्तानी इज अ फ्रूट पंच विच इज बीइंग सोल्ड ऑन द स्ट्रीट्स ऑफ पुणे. तो मस्तानी बहुत पॉपुलर एक तरीके से मिथिकल फिगर वो डेवलप करके आई. So please answer this question.
Thank you, Mirza Saab. Yes, what are the historical sources to know about history of Mastani? There are a lot of bakhars of the period, especially the Peshwa period. Also, there's a lot of correspondence of the Peshwas as the empire started spreading and people were stationed at different places, especially in the north. There is a lot of correspondence, but the correspondence tends to be more administrative, more dealing with economic, you know, the financial aspects. I don't think there is much of anything that one can find, which is, you know, telling in the in a singular authoritative voice about the love story of Bajirao and Mastani. There are stray references and there are archaeological evidences, definitely, because there is in a place called as Pabar, there is her Kabbar is there. Also, there are certain places where Mastani Mahal one can find. Also in the western parts of Pune, there is an area which is earmarked as Mastani Bagh. So one can find traces, material traces, but in terms of historical sources, as in archival sources, very little is available. But the continued question of Mirza Saab is very interesting, that when the love story of Bajirao Mastani started appearing in literature and arts for the first time, around 1955, one finds a movie that was made, and that was called as Mastani. Movie, I don't think it was a big hit, but the movie was made, and obviously they felt that it was a topic that was worth making a movie about. So in the 20th century, definitely the individual love story between Bajirao and Mastani started gaining popularity as far as literature is concerned. There is also this phenomenon as far as Marathi literature is concerned of historical novels. Just the way we were, you know, critically looking at movies as, you know, they are the medium, they are the ways, means in which people try to have an understanding of the past. Similarly, in the 1970s and 80s and 90s in Maharashtra, there was this huge surge of historical novels, historical in inverted commas, because they were largely ahistorical novels, trying to show things such as, you know, the last Peshwa was shown as if he was a great person in a novel called as Mantra Vegra. Also, there was this play, theatrical play, which tried to somewhat explore the relationship, the tensions between perceived tensions, not the real tensions, between Chhatrapati Shivaji and his son. So there were these mischiefs that were managed by a number of literary figures as far as 1970s, 80s, 90s are concerned. They tried to you know, subvert the historical narratives that were available through authentic sources and tried to show something that did not happen. So a kind of pseudo-mnesia was created, if one can use the term here, by through the medium of literature. So one does find narratives about Bajirao and Mastani's love story in such historical novels, yes, definitely, in Marathi language. But as far as the authentic source materials are concerned, archival source materials, there are very few that are available. And those are in the forms of bakhars and also certain kinds of correspondence, which is available in Marathi on archive.org. You may, Mirza Saab, contact me and I'll send you some PDFs if possible.
Right. There is a question by Ali Haider. Who did Bajirao love most as his spouse? Was it Mastani or Kashbai? Ali Haider, I would say leave it to Bajirao to explain why. How are we going to tell you? Was Mastani a Muslim or Pranami? Don't you think this movie, this film failed to show the father of Mastani, that is Chhatarsal, belonged to very pro-Islamic Hindu sect called as Pranami, and was a series Kashi Bai Bajirao Ballal made to counter Bajirao Mastani?
Yeah, I'll take them in the reverse order. And I do not really know anything about the television series because I'm really illiterate when it comes to television, which is not a good thing to do because as a person who's interested in history, I should be more aware of the narratives that are floated in the media. But these days it is just impossible to keep abreast of all the developments on so many different channels. So I really do not know if Kashibai Bajirao Ballal, the TV series, was what kind of a narrative came through the series. I do not know. About the sect, yes, definitely there is this ambiguity about who really Mastani was. Was she really a Muslim person, or was she daughter of a Muslim lady and her father was a Hindu? Such ambiguities are definitely floating in the, as far as the source materials are concerned. What I would point out, or what I would try to emphasize, is that both Hindu and Muslim, the concepts were quite fluid as far as the 18th century goes. Up until my childhood, and I'm 50 years old, we always had Muslim festivals being celebrated by Hindus. We had peers and we had masjids, and the moment you have to plow your field, the first thing in every season you take that nevedya, that is, you take an offering and offer it to the nearest peer. All sorts of agricultural, very rooted traditions were there, which connected the Hindus with the Muslims and vice versa. So the identity of being a Muslim, being a Hindu, hardly ever probably mattered when it came to, as in case of Jodha Akbar, when it came to political alliances, and also when it came to love affairs of the great and mighty people, and also love affairs of the not so great and mighty people. One can definitely find sources in the archives of the Peshwa Daftar that we have here, or any other archives. There were people who would elope with each other. There were people belonging to different castes, different religions, married people eloping with, different persons. All sorts of relationships which were trying to transgress the boundaries of so-called acceptance of the society were happening. And this was simply one of them. That is my take. But then the question arises, why so much of resistance to it? And the answer definitely is in the fact that Mastani gave a son to Bajirao. She was always treated as a kanchani, that is, somebody who's a cheap woman, quote unquote. That is not my opinion, of course, but she was treated as a lady who's not very respected. But that can be attributed to the usual jingoism or xenophobia of any society. When she delivers a son, and when the question comes of making him a legal heir kind of to Bajirao, and when the fortunes have considerably increased as far as the Maratha Empire is concerned, that is the time when probably the sharpness of the resistance increases. Because earlier, yes, she was not accepted in the Peshwa household, but it was perfectly all right for the Peshwa to construct a different palace for her, and she was, living in that palace in the western parts of Pune. So, having a wife from a different religion or having such a relationship is not something which was very, very unusual. I think it has a lot to do with the resources, the succession, the heir part of it. And the last question is, who did Bajirao love the most as his spouse? I think the notions of love that we have today in terms of individual love between two different persons, I do not know if these same notions carried the same kind of weight as far as the 18th century is concerned. So one really doesn't know. Also, the manifestation of love, we really do not have any specific word for the way we have I love you, me prem karte. It's a very concocted kind of a linguistic arrangement of words. It doesn't come naturally as far as the Marathi language is concerned. So I don't know whether that kind of a one-to-one person love was manifested ever by any of the lovers here.
I would also like to add something to what Shraddha said, and that is that you know, one must ponder over two facts. One, as Shraddha herself pointed out, that as far as real, concrete historical information itself is concerned, there is a paucity of that. I mean, legend is much more there rather than the actualities, what was the fact, number one. Number two, let us also not forget that this binary of Hindu-Muslim is a very modern construct. In fact, Shivaji would ape the Bijapur, Golconda, and the Mughal rulers rather than some other co-religionists who were ruling during that period of time. His entire administration, his entire, you know, philosophy was based on these so-called Muslim rulers. He was not least concerned. If one believes Peter Mandi, most of the Brahmins under Shivaji were in jail. So, as far as that period is concerned, these were not the considerations. The consideration was, I would agree with Shraddha on that possibly this lady Mastani belonged to a social order which was lesser in hierarchy than the Peshwas themselves. Kanchani, inhone term use kiya. That actually would explain everything. Why she was being discriminated against, even not only by the family, but even the other Marathas. For example, Shraddha also pointed out, why do others hate Mastani? Obviously, possibly not because of religion, but because of the caste or the social order to which she belonged to. So let us, keep this in mind, that when we are talking about some past century, let us not transport the present century, you know, thought to that period. Us period mein bilkul thinking alag thi. Ek example dekh ke Shraddha mein aage badhunga. Babar Nama, Babar ka bada aajkal Babar Musalmanon ke liye ek hero aur Advani ji ke liye ek Babar ki aulad ka baap. If you read, he's a brute. जो एक एक कंस्ट्रक्ट में जो दिखाया जाता है, जनरली आप बाबर का नाम लीजिए और आपके ज़हन में एक बारबेरियन एक सामने आता है. वन फॉरगेट्स हिज पोएट्री, वन फॉरगेट्स एवरीथिंग. इनफैक्ट ही राइट्स इन हिज अकाउंट हिमसेल्फ अबाउट हिमसेल्फ दैट ही फेल इन लव विद अ यंग मैन, विद अ बॉय, एंड ही पाइंड फॉर दैट बॉय. होश खो बैठे थे. आज अगर कोई हम में से कोई ऐसा करेगा तो उस चीज को छुपाएगा, बताएगा नहीं. देखिए, हर पीरियड के एथिक्स और मोड्स और सोशल वो बिल्कुल अलग अलग होती है. व्हेन बाबर इज मेंशनिंग दैट फैक्ट अबाउट हिज लव फॉर दैट बॉय, वो बहुत आउटस्पोकन नहीं हो रहे. फॉर हिम दैट इज नॉट समथिंग विच इज एक्स्ट्राऑर्डिनरी. लेट अस असेस दीज पीपल कीपिंग इन माइंड द टाइम स्पैन इन विच दे लिव. है ना, जो प्रॉब्लम कहाँ आती है मूवी मेकर्स को भी, हम जैसों को भी, और जो जनरल है उनको, लोगों को भी, कि जब वो ये भूल जाते हैं कि इस टाइम पीरियड में कितने सोशल नॉर्म्स, मोर्स, हर चीज बदल गई है, और आजकल के पैरामीटर को हम उस पीरियड में अप्लाई करने लगते हैं. नाउ देयर इज अ क्वेश्चन बाय सैयद अली काजिम, इज द मूवी नॉट अबाउट रिहैबिलिटेटिंग अ रॉबर स्टेट इमर्जिंग आउट ऑफ फितना? Rajput sources, we are told, have used four-letter words freely for the Marathas because of the plundering nature of their state. I mean, possibly Sayyid Ali Kazim is inspired by Al Hind, that book by kya naam tha uska? Arey, Al Hind ka jo author hai, jisne fitna ka term bahut use kiya hai, Andhravik. So. Kazim has a very important question. Is the movie about rehabilitating a rubber state emerging out of fitna? Rajput sources, we are told, have used four letter words freely for the Marathas because of the plundering nature of their state. Your response.
Yeah. Thank you, Kazim Saab, for your question. I would not say that Marathas were a rubber state. I would say that they definitely had, in the beginning, the expansion was an aim, but eventually after a particular region came under their influence, they did start with the processes of establishing administrative processes in the region. So I would not say that the Marathas, even if we are speaking of the Peshwa period, after Bajirao and his descendants, that is, after they started expanding into the north. I won't say that these are just a state which is dependent only on, you know, tribute money. They did, especially in case of Malwa, in case of Khandesh, in case of Orissa, and there's a beautiful work by Professor C.R. Das from our university, wherein he says that the Marathas, when they established their rule in Orissa, they began to patronize the building of temples, they began to patronize the writing of new pieces of literature. So such cultural activities, such more long-lasting kind of activities were definitely undertaken by the Marathas once they got the time, of course. I mean, one has to be fair in the sense that first one conquers, and that can be seen in case of Aurangzeb coming down into Maharashtra as well. First he conquers a region, and the moment he is sure that this region is now under his rule, he starts giving orders to his provincial officials, saying that, okay, now these people are under our protection and they should be given whatever administrative facilities that are due to our subjects. So this process, the fluidity is always there in both cases, when it comes to the Mughals coming down into the Deccan and the Marathas expanding into the north as well. Going back slightly to Professor Rezavi's point about Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj and the Bahmani influence, the influence of the Adil Shahi, Nizam Shahi, Qutub Shahi, and the other states in the Deccan. I can share a very delightful sentence from Qutub Shah's letter that was written to another ruler, the Adil Shahi ruler. He says that the Mughals are trying to win over us, and they are trying to say that cooperate with us, and what we will do is we will all come together and we will attack on the Marathas. And Qutub Shah says that I have written back to the Mughals saying, Unoku hua to hamno ko hua. whatever you are doing to them, that is something that is going to happen to us as well. So the regional identity, the affinity of the belonging to a specific region, a specific culture, which we call Dakhni culture, was definitely there as far as the different Bahmani powers in the Dakhan region were concerned. Having said that, the use of four-letter words, that happens all the time. I mean, earlier also I mentioned jingoism and xenophobia. Everybody is, entitled to use bad language. I mean, it's not fair, but I mean, that happens all the time. People curse their enemies, and also there have been sociological studies of the use of curse words, in the adrenaline rush that it gives us. When we have to take a certain action. So no harm in pointing out that there was no love lost between certain rulers, between each other. But that was the rule of the day. I mean, after they had their alliances, things settled down. And in spite of the alliances, or even if they had enmity also, there was always this element of political realities. Like when Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj managed to escape from the Nazar Qaid of the Mughals, it was the Rajputs which were looked at with suspicion. So the Mughals suspected that Rajputs must have helped him escape the prison walls. So fluid kinds of relations, as in politics, even today we say there are no permanent enemies and there are strange bedfellows. Happens. Earlier there was a question about the descendants of Mastani and Bajirao, and yes, that is a very interesting question, Rumina ma'am. Descendants of Mastani are still there. They come together when there are any family get-togethers of the Peshwas. The orthodoxy in those days, they did not allow them to follow the Hindu way of life. And so even today, they follow the Muslim way of life. But there is definitely, especially in the last few years, there's definitely a great deal of camaraderie between the different descendants of Peshwas, including the descendants of Mastani. So they are there, and they, if you search in the Marathi media, you'll find every so often we find news pieces about the descendants of Mastani. So they're there, and one can find them in the news pieces. Also, a question from you, Hassan Saab.
Yeah, it seems that society was much more
in those times than it might be today. What do you think might be the reasons for this regression? No specific reasons for the Maharashtrians being regressive as against others, but not to take your question lightly, Hassan Saab. I understand that definitely there are signs of people trying to go back to a pristine past which never really existed. These are really dangerous tendencies of trying to say that we have always been like that, and we have been the upholders of such and such great traditions, which is simply not true. So as far as the Maharashtrian people are concerned, I would say that arguments, debates, fights, quarrels, and being assertive, these are definitely characteristic features of the people of Maharashtra. We will not go gently into the good night ever. This might sound a little, patriotic or whatever, having love for your, boasting about your own Janam Bhumi. But I have noticed this in the interactions with many Maharashtrian people, that the people here tend to be vocal, they tend to be assertive, and they tend to not refrain from saying you know, things out and aloud, like just like sir said earlier that Babur was not ashamed of being you know, having a gay relationship, or at least a desire, if not a relationship. So Maharashtrians, I would say, are also like that. They are outspoken and not ashamed to say what they feel like.
There's a question by Zainab Nakhvi. Thanks for the presentation. The benefit that you refer to, I believe, is achieving jingoistic nationalism and using history for political propaganda. Apart from this movie, would you also refer a bit to movies like Padmavat and Tanhaji, both of which posit Muslim rulers as animalistic and the Hindu Rajas as people who love their morals, their family and wives, who demonize Muslims?
Yes, completely agree with you, Zainab Sahab, that there has been this dehumanizing and a completely, completely insensitive depiction of the Muslim rulers as far as a number of movies are concerned. This phenomenon of depicting the other with O capital is not something that is new. It has been the case, and this brings me to my ancient Indian history part. This has been the case throughout our history. So in case of Rigveda, we find the people who are strangers for the Rigvedic pastoral people, they call them Anasa, Rudravag. So these are people who have got no nose. These are people who have very ubad-kabad, very wrong kind of language. So hatred for the other, or suspicion about the other, is not something that is new. But the scales to which it has gone with the help of technology, with the help of kind of mass communication that is available at our disposal in the 21st century, the scale is frightening, definitely. So as you say, this achieving jingoistic nationalism and using history for political propaganda, use and abuse of history has been a topic of my research interest as well, Zainab Sahab, and completely agree with you that this keeps happening. I hope, I mean, I can only hope that endeavors such as this Asha or Ganga Jamni Tehzeeb, they try and win over many people on the other side of hatred, which is just holding hands together and trying to you know, enjoy the journey, which is beautiful if we are together. So that would be my emotional answer. Did the Peshwas and the king belong to different castes? Oh yes, they did. Oh yes, they did. Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, he belonged to what has come to be known as the Maratha caste today. In those days, there were different names given to the caste where Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj belonged. And the Peshwas, the Bajirao Peshwa, and his the first Peshwa was Balaji Vishwanath, and his descendants, they are Brahmins, Brahmins belonging to a specific caste called as the Chittapavan Brahmins. Now, as all castes go, these castes were very fluid in those days. So when Balaji Vishwanath came in and the Peshwas became the rulers, they were hated by the other branch of Brahmins who were powerful locally as far as Western India is concerned. So there is this tussle between the Chitpavan or Konkanastha Brahmins and the Deshastha Brahmins and many other branches of Brahmins as well. Similarly, there is the fluidity as far as the caste of Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj is also concerned. So yes, they did belong to very different castes in the caste hierarchy.
Well, Shraddha Ji, I mean, your lecture appears to be very popular in the sense that it's gaining popularity. I mean, there are many questions, but I'm sorry to everyone, we are out of time. Naturally, we should have taken all the queries and all the comments which were being put up, but it is next to impossible. There was one very long question from Ali Kazim, who teaches at AMU. Kazim Saab, because it was not a question, it was a comment, and I totally agree with you that, as far as the Bambaiya bhi mat kaho, balki Indian historic flicks are concerned, they are actually not up to the mark. If you compare them with the attempts which had earlier been made in Hollywood or elsewhere in Europe, who can forget Ben-Hur and Ten Commandments, mythical stories, but depicted in a fashion which would make you think that you have entered into a page of history with authentic, quite a few things which would make it authentic, feel authentic. Or for that matter, later on, not only sirf ye nahi ki angrez kar sakte hain, European kar sakte hain. In fact, the recent attempts which were made by the this Turkish film industry, or should I say, not the film industry, but the grand serials which they have come up with. I am referring to especially two of them, Ertugrul, Resurrection Ertugrul, and Usman. Usman at a second level, Ertugrul at the first, where once again the theme is something jo kitna history hai. Shraddha ji pointed out about Mastani, bahut kaam uske bare mein likha hua hai, myth zyada hai. Ertugrul bhi waise hi figure hai, hardly 3 pages mein puri history hai uski. Aur ek ghante ke 5 saal tak unhone सीरियल चलाया, तो उस पेजेस को, 3 pages को. स्टिल आई वुड से दैट इंडियन फिल्म मेकर्स, डायरेक्टर्स शुड लर्न फ्रॉम दैट फिल्म मेकर, मैं उसका नाम भूल रहा हूँ, जो भी नाम है उसका, हाउ टू हैंडल अ थीम ऑफ हिस्ट्री. इर्तुगुरुल माइट नॉट बी वेरी वेरी हिस्टोरिक, because उसके बारे में आइडिया नहीं है, but the way that tribal life has been depicted, the way that technology has been depicted, the way that migration of the Turkish tribes from one place to another has been depicted, the way they fight with each other and everything else, kab teer chalega, kab talwar se jang hogi, kab ghode pe sawar honge, kab kya hoga, I mean these are the facts which have been very authentically depicted. Abhi recently hamare abhi OTT ke upar ek Mughals pe ek serial shuru hua hai, jiska pichle saal dikhaya tha, aur Babar abhi is saal jo unhone depict kiya tha, 6 ya 7 episodes ka ek chota sa, horrible to put it mildly, dark sets, kuch samajh mein nahi aata kya कहना चाह रहे हैं, कर रहे हैं. तो आई थिंक सम टोटल वुड बी श्रद्धा जी के एक चीज हमें याद रखनी चाहिए कि देखिए हम हिस्टोरियंस बड़े क्रूअल होते हैं, हर चीज में हिस्ट्री ढूंढते हैं. वो ढूंढना थोड़ा सा बंद कर दें, क्योंकि लाइफ इम्पॉसिबल हो जाएगी. अरे 3 घंटे मूवी देखने जाइए, देखिए, वापस आ जाइए, हिस्ट्री क्लास में पढ़ाइएगा, वो उस पर हिस्ट्री नहीं है. बिल्कुल मान लीजिए कि जहां तक के इंडियन फिल्म्स एंड सीरियल्स हैं, डोंट एक्सपेक्ट मच फ्रॉम दीज पीपल, दे वुड. हाँ, एक चीज जो डेंजरस है, विच शुड बी पॉइंटेड आउट अगेन एंड अगेन, आर द अल्टीरियर मोटिव्स ऑफ सम ऑफ दीज मेकर्स ऑफ मूवीज, वेयर दे वॉन्ट टू डिवाइड द पीपल. और आज ऑडियंसेस को मैं ये बताना चाहूंगा कि वन ऑफ द रीजंस व्हाई वी केप्ट दिस टाइप ऑफ अ लेक्चर ऑन बाजीराव मस्तानी वाज दिस फैक्ट दैट वी एज यू नो कॉन्शियस सिटीजंस ऑफ इंडिया शुड ऑल्सो बी अवेयर ऑफ हाउ अटेम्प्ट्स आर बीइंग मेड. मैं एक चीज आपको लास्ट में, बिल्कुल बहुत टाइम हो गया, बस लास्ट में एक चीज पॉइंट आउट करता चलूं. जो ये पूरी मूवी बनाई संजय लीला भंसाली ने, इस पे अगर रिव्यूज आप पढ़ें तो रिव्यू में कहा गया कि वेरी टाइमली एट अ टाइम व्हेन सो मच रिलीजियस स्ट्राइफ इज गोइंग ऑन, संजय लीला भंसाली कम्स अप विद अ मूवी ऑफ लव अफेयर बिटवीन अ हिंदू एंड अ मुस्लिम. अपेरेंटली क्या है लॉडेटरी दिस थिंग, जब आप लव जिहाद की बात हो रही हो उस पीरियड में एक मूवी बनाई जाए जिसमें एक मराठा पेशवा हो और एक मुस्लिम एक महिला हो, उनका वो दिखाया जाए इन स्पाइट ऑफ ऑल द डिफरेंसेस ऑफ रिलीजन एंड कल्चर एंड सो ऑन एंड सो फॉर्थ, तो लॉडेट्री है और इसीलिए रिव्यूज इसके बहुत से बड़े अच्छे आए. लेकिन यही एक जो नाजी जर्मनी ने हमको एक सबक सिखाया है कि गोयबल्स की तरह कैसे सटल तरीके से मैसेज आप सीप इन करेंगे. आज जो श्रद्धा ने बताया, श्रद्धा डिड नॉट पॉइंट आउट के इट्स सो लॉडेटरी दैट इट्स अ हिंदू मुस्लिम अफेयर एंड दे वर सो ओपन. नहीं, व्हाट शी हैज एम्फसाइज्ड टुडे इज कि अगर जो इसे देखने जा रहा है व्हाट टाइप ऑफ साइलेंट मैसेज ही इज ट्राइंग टू गेट, सटल तरीके से हाउ दैट प्रोपेगेंडा जो आज फैलाया जा रहा है, जो आज बहुत हद तक फैल गया है, कैसे हमारे कल्चर हमारे ये मूवीज हमारे सीरियल्स इनका फायदा उठा के ये सब अटेम्प्ट्स ली जा रही हैं. तो दैट इज व्हाई इट इज वेरी वेरी एसेंशियल फॉर अस कि हम थोड़ा निट पिकिंग करें और न सिर्फ खुद समझें बल्कि अपने इनोसेंट यंग जनरेशन को भी समझाने की बात करें कि जिस वक्त आप मूवी देखें रिलैक्स रहिए, ठीक है, लेकिन कॉन्शियस भी रहिए कि कहीं आप ब्रेन वॉश तो नहीं हो. डोंट फॉरगेट द रूट्स ऑफ योर ओन सिविलाइजेशन. रिमेंबर यस मराठास एंड मुगल्स वर टू डिफरेंट एंटिटीज, बट ऑल्सो रिमेंबर दैट शिवाजी one of the greatest opponents of Aurangzeb, or you can say that Aurangzeb ka sabse to jadunath sarkar keh gaye the you know Deccan ulcer jahan ek bar jo uske chakkar mein pade to kabhi bahar nahi aaye. In spite of that the first original great Maratha Shivaji was all praise for Sulhekul. He stood for Sulhekul. Please Shivaji aur Aurangzeb ke is रीजनल और अदरवाइज फाइट को कम्युनल फाइट मत बनाइए. दूसरी चीज, शिवाजी वाले मराठास और पेशवा एम्पायर, दे आर टू डिफरेंट थिंग्स. रिमेंबर ऑल्सो दैट बाय 18th सेंचुरी, बाय द टाइम दैट द मुगल एम्पायर वॉज एंडिंग, जब पीरियड है महदजी सिंधिया का और यहां लेसर मुगल्स दिल्ली तापालंग हुकूमत कर रहे हैं, इट इज द पेशवाज एंड मराठास हु आर एक्चुअली कंट्रोलिंग द मुगल एम्पायर. जो हम आप बात करते हैं ना कि इट वाज अल्टीमेटली 1857 जिसमें वो खत्म कर दिए गए थे और अंग्रेजों ने ये किया था, नहीं, इवन बिफोर दैट उनको या तो सैयद ब्रदर्स कंट्रोल कर रहे थे और ये मराठा कंट्रोल कर रहे थे, है ना. लेकिन इनके जो पॉलिटी थी, इनकी जो थिंकिंग थी, वहां कहीं के ऊपर भी हिंदू मुस्लिम नहीं आ रहा था. पॉलिटिक्स थी वो रहेगी. लेकिन हमेशा इस चीज को याद रखिए कि इंडियन हिस्ट्री बिफोर अ फ्यू डिकेड्स वॉज नेवर अ हिंदू मुस्लिम डिवाइड, वेदर इट वॉज बाबर, वेदर इट वॉज औरंगजेब, वेदर इट वॉज शिवाजी और whether it was somebody else. सब अपने वर्चस्व की लड़ाई कर रहे थे, अपने पॉलिटिकल पावर को बढ़ाने की बात कर रहे थे. इस फैक्ट को कभी मत भूलिएगा. जो फैक्ट आज इन मूवीज के थ्रू, सीरियल्स के थ्रू, कल्चरल ऑनस्लॉट के थ्रू हमको डिवाइड करने की कोशिश कर रही है. श्रद्धा, यू सेड दैट यू आर 50, आई एम 60, सो आई कैन टेक योर नेम विद इम्प्यूनिटी. श्रद्धा जी मुझे कहने की जरूरत नहीं है. अब 60 साल का हो गया, इसीलिए आप देख रहे होंगे बहुत बोल रहा हूँ, सखिया गया. लेकिन आई शुड थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर कमिंग ऑन दिस डे विच इज एसोसिएटेड विद शिवाजी and presenting this beautiful lecture to us. I hope that the people would gain something out of it. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Pleasure.